See you. Welcome to worship this morning at FBC Palmyra. My name is Paul Reese, for those of you who don't know me, and we're glad you're here this morning. Welcome to worship. This morning is our Hospitality Sunday, okay? Hospitality Sunday, so it's kind of our Vacation Bible School celebration time, and it's going to be a little bit different this morning. We're going to teach you a new song. That the VBS kids have been working on this week, and I'm going to have the VBS kids come up in a minute. We're all going to come up, and they're going to help with our call to worship. Our call to worship is their main theme verse for the week, Ephesians 2:10. And so we're glad you're here. It's a great Sunday to show some hospitality. We're going to have a picnic after church. It's going to be at the park, and so I'll pray at the end of the service. And you can go out and line up and start fixing your plate. You don't have to wait for me to get out there. I'm a little late showing up out there, but just you can go out to the park. It's in shelter number one next to the tennis courts, and when we'll eat out there, we'll have a good time together. And so VBS families, we're glad you're here. Thanks for coming and making us a part of your Sunday. And for anyone else who's visiting with us, we have a Connect card. You can fill out a Connect card. You can put this in the offering plate when it comes by. You can leave it in your seat. And Pastor Josh or myself would love to make your acquaintance, get to know you, find out how we can be serving you and praying for you. And so we'd love for you to fill that out if you are visiting with us. Got a few announcements for us this morning as we get started. Feel free to move about this morning. If you got to get up, you got to stretch the back, you got to use the bathroom, you got a squirrely kid, you can come down the middle aisle. You're not going to bother anyone. All the bathrooms are out these doors down to the right, and it's not a problem, okay? You're going to be fine. Don't forget about the picnic right after church. It's out at the park. We got church night at the fair tonight, 7 p.m. All the churches with the Ministry Alliance get together, and there's a time of singing out there, and so you want to be out there for that tonight. Let's see. Don't forget about your Building the Vision 4. We're looking at renovating the Stuhlman building that we purchased this past year, and so you want to fill out those surveys that we gave out to everyone. You want to fill those out and have those back by August 7th. The garage door is open, so you can go and tour that building. If you haven't looked at it, you can go look at the building next door and walk through it to see about that space. We're really making plans to make that a hospitable space that we can do ministry in. Let's see. Don't forget about the recycling center. So we're scheduled for August 20th to help with the recycling center. So you can wear your FBC Palmyra t-shirt to that and help out at the recycling center from 10 to 2 p.m., and we're going to be out there with the energy of 10,000 burning suns, friends. That's my goal, to help Brother Jim out there, be out there. So if you want to volunteer for that, we'd encourage you to come. Let Josh and I know that you're able to do that. And then finally, August 28th, don't forget, the fish fry is coming up. And it is a sanctified holiday, you know, around here. So there is the fish fry at Camp Enloe on August 28th. You can start swimming at 2, and then we eat at 5, okay? All right, so those are some announcements for us this morning. To kick us off, before our call to worship, we're going to do a song. We're going to do a special song. So Maya, come up. Jill, Chloe, come up. And they're going to lead us in some motions. Now, don't get hurt with these motions. Don't throw out your knee or anything like that, okay? But they're going to teach us these motions. We're going to go through the motions, and then we're going to have the VBS kids help us with our call to worship. So if you're a VBSer, you can come on down. Come on down. Come right in the front here. Vacation Bible School. Yeah, VBSer. Is that? Yeah, Ezekiel. Come on, don't be shy, Ezekiel. That's it. Come down front here. All right. Now, these aren't all of our VBS kids, right? I can't remember the exact number we had. 36? Average 36 that we had total. Yeah, you can line up here. Here, I kind of want to interview you kids, okay? Let you guys talk a little bit. All right, I want you to just tell me your favorite part of Vacation Bible School, okay? Your favorite part of Vacation Bible School.
My favorite part of Vacation Bible School was the snacks and the games and the singing.
And the singing, awesome. Adelaide, do you want to tell us your favorite part? Okay, what's your favorite part? It's okay. We understand. Favorite part?
Snacks.
All right, snacks.
Songs.
Songs.
Games.
Games.
Snacks.
My
favorite part is that I love the songs and everything else.
Oh, okay. That was good. Uh-oh.
The party poopers.
Oh, no. That was Everett's group. They were the, well, it was really just Bentley and Everett. Here, step off this, Ezekiel. Okay. All right. Favorite part?
Learning about God.
Learning about God.
Jumping on the bouncy house.
The bouncy house.
Games.
Okay. Bouncy house.
Bouncy house.
The bouncy house. Okay. All right. Awesome. All right. Give these kids a hand. All right. Appreciate you, kids. All right. Everyone stand up. Spread out a little bit. Spread out a little bit. All right. Don't hurt yourself. Don't hurt your neighbor. Maya, lead us in these motions. Go ahead. I'm going to step down here. Yeah, go ahead.
Jump up, jump out without clasping your hands, and then turn around. And then you just repeat the chorus again. So.
We're on a mission to share all that God can do. We'll be a witness to His power.
Awesome, kids. Praise the Lord. So in addition to those songs, all the worship songs this morning too, we taught the kids at Vacation Bible School, and they have motions with them to help the retention, help them to remember those. And so during worship this morning, Julie is going to be up here actually, and she's going to be doing the motions that we were doing with the kids so they can, where they are, they can sing along as well. All right, for now is our call to worship. And our call to worship was the theme verse for our Vacation Bible School this year, and it's Ephesians 2:10 that the kids will help us say. Ephesians 2:10, all right? And we'll all read this together as well for our call to worship this morning. This is the word of the Lord speaking to us, and it says this, ready? For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Amen. All right, kids, why don't you guys find a seat, and I'll pray for us, okay? Find your seats. Lord Jesus, we pray that this morning, as we think about the good works you have prepared for us, we pray that you would be glorified in us, believing in you, trusting in you, and the work that you have done with your perfect life, with your sacrificial death, and with your victorious resurrection, so that we might become new creations in you, so that we might live for your glory. We pray that would be convicting to us this morning as we draw near to you by the truth of your word. Would you be glorified, we ask, for your name's sake, for your kingdom's purposes in our lives, we pray. Amen.
Would you remain standing as we sing together?
Of highs to the depths of the sea, creations revealing your majesty, from the colors of thought to the fragrance of sweet, every creature you meet in the song that is. Exclaiming
control the cosmos, everything in the earth, and yet he looks down on us and loves us. Lamentations 3 says that because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for his mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness.
Bibles with you, please turn with me to the book of Exodus. Our sermon text is Exodus chapter 28. That can be found on page 86 on that black Bible in front of you. If you don't own a Bible, please take that one home. Consider it our gift to you. If you're new to the Bible, the large numbers are the chapters, the small ones are the verses. We're going to be in Exodus chapter 28. This is God's holy word, inspired and given to us by his prophet Moses. And he says this, Then bring near to you Aaron, your brother, and his sons with him, from among the people of Israel, to serve me as priests. Aaron and Aaron's sons, Nadab and Abihu, Eleazar and Ithamar, and you shall make holy garments for Aaron, your brother, for glory and for beauty. You shall speak to all the skillful, whom I have filled with a spirit of skill, that they make Aaron's garments to consecrate him for my priesthood. These are the garments that they shall make: a breastpiece, an ephod, a robe, a coat of checker work, a turban, and a sash. They shall make holy garments for Aaron, your brother, and his sons to serve me as priests. They shall receive gold, blue and purple and scarlet yarns, and fine twined linen. And they shall make the ephod of gold, of blue and purple and scarlet yarns, and of fine twined linen, skillfully worked. It shall have two shoulder pieces attached to its two edges, so that it may be joined together. And the skillfully woven band on it shall be made like it, and be of one piece with it, of gold, blue, and purple, and scarlet yarns, and fine twined linen. You shall make two onyx stones, and engrave on them the names of the sons of Israel, six of their names on the one stone, and the names of the remaining six on the other stone, in the order of their birth. As a jeweler engraves signets, so shall you engrave the two stones with the names of the sons of Israel. You shall enclose them in settings of gold filigree, and you shall set the two stones on the shoulder pieces of the ephod as stones of remembrance for the sons of Israel. And Aaron shall wear their names before the Lord on his two shoulders for remembrance. You shall make settings of gold filigree and two chains of pure gold twisted like cords, and you shall attach the corded chains to the settings. You shall make a breastpiece of judgment in skilled work. In the style of the ephod you shall make it, of gold, blue, and purple, and scarlet yarns, and fine twined linen you shall make it. It shall be square and doubled, a span its length, and a span its breadth. You shall set it in four rows of stones. A row of sardius, topaz, and carbuncle shall be the first row, and the second row an emerald, a sapphire, and a diamond, and the third row a jacinth, an agate, and an amethyst, the fourth row a beryl, an onyx, and a jasper. They shall be set in gold filigree. There shall be 12 stones with their names according to the names of the sons of Israel. They shall be like signets, each engraved with its name for the 12 tribes. You shall make for the breastpiece twisted chains like cords of pure gold. And you shall make for the breastpiece two rings of gold, and put the two rings on the two edges of the breastpiece. And you shall put the two cords of gold in the two rings at the edges of the breastpiece. The two ends of the two cords you shall attach to the two settings of filigree, and so attach it in front to the shoulder pieces of the ephod. You shall make two rings of gold and put them at the two ends of the breastpiece on its inside edge next to the ephod. And you shall make two rings of gold and attach them in front to the lower part of the two shoulder pieces of the ephod at its seam above the skillfully woven band of the ephod. And they shall bind the breastpiece by its rings to the rings of the ephod with a lace of blue, so that it may lie on the skillfully woven band of the ephod, so that the breastpiece shall not come loose from the ephod. So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel in the breastpiece of judgment on his heart when he goes into the holy place to bring them to regular remembrance before the Lord. And in the breastpiece of judgment you shall put the Urim and the Thummim, and they shall be on Aaron's heart when he goes in before the Lord. Thus Aaron shall bear the judgment of the people of Israel on his heart before the Lord regularly. You shall make the robe of the ephod all of blue. It shall have an opening for the head in the middle of it, with a woven binding around the opening, like the opening in a garment, so that it may not tear. On its hem you shall make pomegranates of blue and purple and scarlet yarns around its hem, with bells of gold between them, a gold bell and a pomegranate, a golden bell and a pomegranate, around the hem of the robe. And it shall be on Aaron when he ministers, and its sound shall be heard when he goes into the holy place before the Lord, and when he comes out, so that he does not die. You shall make a plate of pure gold and engrave on it like the engravings of a signet holy to the Lord. And you shall fasten it on the turban by a cord of blue. It shall be on the front of the turban. It shall be on Aaron's forehead. And Aaron shall bear any guilt from the holy things that the people of Israel consecrate as their holy gifts. It shall regularly be on his forehead, that they may be accepted before the Lord. You shall weave the coat in checker work of fine linen, and you shall make a turban of fine linen, and you shall make a sash embroidered with needlework. For Aaron's sons you shall make coats and sashes and caps. You shall make them for glory and beauty, and you shall put them on Aaron your brother, and on his sons with them, and shall anoint them, and ordain them, and consecrate them, that they may serve me as priests. You shall make for them linen undergarments to cover their naked flesh. They shall reach from the hips to the thighs, and they shall be on Aaron and on his sons when they go into the tent of meeting, or when they come near the altar to minister in the holy place, lest they bear guilt and die. This shall be a statute forever for him and for his offspring after him. This is God's holy word. Let's pray as such.
Let's pray. Pray with me. Lord God, thank you so much for this word. We praise you so much, King Jesus, for being our great high priest who goes before us into the place where we cannot go apart from your blood. So give us faith this morning to comprehend what this passage means for us so that we can be consecrated, so that we can be holy, cleansed of all unrighteousness, forgiven of sin, and know that we belong to you and we belong in your presence forever to fulfill all of your purposes for us, for your glory. We ask this for your name's sake. We pray that you would do this work in our hearts like only you can. We pray. Amen. So this week at Vacation Bible School, we learned we needed a very special spark. Remember that word, kids? Spark. We did a lot of clapping and a lot of sparking. So we needed a special spark in order to have a personal relationship with God. Jesus is that spark. Christ is that spark that everyone needs. Christ is special because Christ is consecrated. That's a big word. Christ is set apart. Christ is set apart as the only. He is the only. He's the only of several things. Christ is the only begotten Son of God. Christ is the only Lord and Savior of the world. Christ is the only way to be forgiven of sins. We all have onlys in life. When you have an only, you treat that only in a very special way. Do you have birthday present that's your most favorite, kids? Yes. So you're going to want to keep that only special present in a special place. We all have many onlys. There are a lot of children in the world. But by God's grace, Julie and I are the parents of only these four. And that is a grace from God. My daughter Chloe excels at music, and she's good at piano and violin. And I tell her, Chloe, these are your only 10 fingers that you have. God gave those to you. Treat them with special care. Treat them well, and they'll treat you well. You have only one life. Treat it with care. You have only one world to live in. We don't live on Mars yet. And even if we could, would you want to? No, you wouldn't. Jesus is the only begotten Son of God, full of grace and truth. No one is full of grace and truth like Jesus. We've been reading through the book of Exodus, so this is what we do. If you're new to our worship service, we read through whole books of the Bible together, usually. Every now and then we'll have like a topical sermon, but we read through whole books and we discover as we read through all these books, all of the topics. There's so many topics that are covered in every chapter of the Bible. And it's amazing to see how God speaks into our lives with issues we're dealing with by using one chapter at a time in our lives. And in this chapter, we come across an only. There's an only here. The priests are the only people in Israel authorized to maintain God's house. So we've learned about the tabernacle, The tabernacle is this moving, traveling tent. And the only people who are charged with stewarding it in this movable tent where there's only one mercy seat, because there's only one throne of God that comes down from heaven to earth, are the priests. You have the priests, and they are set apart. They are consecrated. They are the only ones authorized, and they are the ones who offer sacrifices on the only altar to atone for all the sins of the people, lest God judge them. So there's forgiveness. And when we come to this passage, we see that in this holy place where God dwells, because where God dwells is holy, like whenever God appeared on Mount Sinai in the burning bush, and he said, Moses, take your sandals off your feet because the place where you're standing is holy ground. You have the priests who are barefoot walking around in this holy place where God dwells, doing what God has told them to do. And the main reason why Aaron was so special, because that's what we're looking at this morning. The main reason why Aaron was so special is because Aaron represented the nation. He represented all of the people. Think about that. So this is Hospitality Sunday. What better way to think about showing hospitality than to think about God as the host? God is such a host. God is so hospitable that God, the only Holy One, would invite people into his presence, that the King of the world would allow people to come in and to dwell with him and let him commune, let him speak with him, is miraculous. You have the one true and living God, the only God, inviting into his presence this priest on behalf of the nation so that the nation might receive grace and mercy and blessing and hope and love and everything good God has to give his people. It's so encouraging. And so here's what's really amazing from passages like this that I really want to drive home this morning. Jesus Christ is better than Aaron. He's a better priest because he actually brings us. He brings Gentiles. He brings non-Jews. He brings the world into the presence of God. But you must believe. You must yield. You must trust. You must be a part of the holy nation. You must yield to your great high priest who goes on your behalf before the Father in order to be reconciled to God. So Aaron is unique, but Aaron is pointing to Christ. And so I want to dig into this passage. We're not going to go verse by verse. We are going to look at the heart of the passage, though, and that comes from verse 29. Verse 29 is the heart of Aaron's priesthood. It says this in verse 29 of this passage. So Aaron shall bear the names of the sons of Israel in the breastpiece of judgment on his heart when he goes into the holy place to bring them to regular remembrance before the Lord. So Aaron has on these unusual garments, and I think if our tech will allow us, we're going to have a picture of this. I gave them a picture. I don't know if it's coming up. Thus far, it's not. There it is. Kind of unusual. So if you were to take all the details of this passage and put it together in a picture, and this is help from the ESV Study Bible, you'll see that this is what the priest is wearing. So you have this breastpiece, and you have these stones, and you have the names of the 12 tribes of Israel on these stones on his heart. And he would go into the tabernacle. Do we have the second picture? He would go into this kind of a cross-section of the tabernacle. He would go into this holy place to offer sacrifices to the Lord on behalf of the nation. And so he walks before the Lord in this holy place, representing the entire nation. And like the rest of the world, the whole nation, like the rest of the world, sits in judgment before God. So the mercy seat where the Ark of the Covenant is and the Holy of Holies, that's the footstool of the throne. It's the place where Israel would understand that the throne from heaven touches earth, where God puts his feet down on earth again. And God sits in judgment over the whole world. But in order to interact with him, in order to dwell with him, in order to regain the Garden of Eden, so to be like Adam and Eve who dwelled with God again, you have this priest going before him offering sacrifices, offering blood sprinkled on the mercy seat. Now, he has these garments, and these garments are signifying so many things. And without these garments, he's going to be struck down. If you go to the last verse of the passage, it says this in verse 43, "And they shall be on Aaron and on his sons when they go into the tent of meeting or when they come near the altar to minister to the holy place, lest they bear guilt and die." So as they go in with these royal robes, the robes they're wearing, these garments, are made out of the same material as the curtains with the cherubim woven into them to signify that they belong here. They belong into this place. They've been consecrated into this. It's not just, you know, it's where God dwells. It's this royal, like, throne room is how we should think of it, this kingly realm. And in the breast piece, when they go in these special garments, they're carrying also the Urim and the Thummim. Did you catch that? That's in verse 30. The Urim and the Thummim. Look at verse 30. "And in the breastpiece of judgment, you shall put the Urim and the Thummim, and they shall be on Aaron's heart when he goes in before the Lord. Thus Aaron shall bear the judgment of the people of Israel on his heart before the Lord regularly." Now, we don't really know exactly what these items were, honestly. I mean, no one knows like exactly what kind of objects they were, but they are probably representing something where a judge would use to decide if someone is guilty or innocent. So when you're actually in a courtroom, a judge is going to use these kinds of utensils, if you will, to judge if someone is guilty or someone was innocent. I like to think of them maybe as a gavel, but it's not that. It's something, though. Because in order to know God, you must be declared innocent. You must be declared guiltless. You must have your sins washed away. You must be holy to dwell with God. Most people today believe that in the courtroom of heaven, they're presumed innocent. They're just presumed innocent. They're not bad people. They're good people. Why would God not host us? Why would God not allow us into his presence? Even though they've broken God's law. But a lot of people don't think they have broken God's law until you start talking about the law. And this is how I explained it to kids this week at Vacation Bible School, so this will be familiar to them. But just start going through the laws. Thou shalt not steal. Have you ever stolen anything? Well, you're a thief. Thou shalt not lie. Have you ever lied before? Well, you're a liar. Have you ever cursed the name of God? Remember it's God's name and keep it holy. Have you ever cursed God's name? That's blasphemy to do that. Thou shalt not covet. Have you ever looked at something your neighbor owned and you wanted it? You coveted it. You had to have it. You saw what they had and you wanted it. That's called discontentment. Have you ever loved something or someone more than God? God calls that idolatry. So think about this, and this is just a few of all the commands. Before God, we're idolatrous, discontent, blaspheming, lying thieves. That's who we are. And the one holding us accountable for breaking the law is holy. Perfectly holy. And it's not like, well, God's holy and we're not. We only know what holiness is because of God. Holiness comes from God. And God's judgment against people is simply this: guilty. Guilty. And yet, this is what's so amazing. This is why the gospel's good news. It's through intercession. Through intercession, through the atoning work of the priesthood. So through Aaron, going on behalf, what a job Aaron had, going on behalf of the people to offer the shedding of blood. And it was understood that there was a sense in which Aaron bore the guilt of the people. That's what it says, isn't it? So it's not like that guilt is just on the sacrifices. There is a sense in which Aaron goes bearing the guilt. It's in these garments. It's represented bearing the guilt of the people too and himself before the Lord, that people receive grace. And what a grace it is. So God is so gracious in the Old Testament. So God's judging, he's judgmental, and he's gracious. People love putting God in the boxes. Have you heard before? Well, the Old Testament's about judgment, the New Testament's about grace. That's how the Bible works. Don't you know that? It's a little bit more dynamic than that. It's a little bit more colorful. There's more dimension to what's actually going on. In the Old Testament, God is so gracious. If you were an Israelite, so you're in this tribe, millions of people, about 2 million people, you're camped out in the wilderness, and you're there, you wouldn't have to go before the Lord for your sin. You wouldn't have to offer sacrifices. You wouldn't have to go in and sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat to bear your own sins before the Lord. Aaron's going to do it for you. Wouldn't you want to listen to those bells ringing? So there's bells on the bottom of his garments so that whenever he goes in, they can hear him inside of there. They can't see him, but they know he's in there. Jingle bells takes on a whole new meaning, doesn't it? When you're listening to those bells, I mean, you want to hear those bells ringing because he's going for you into that place with blood to sprinkle on the mercy seat. What an incredible responsibility. What an incredible act of love. That's love. So Aaron is, he has a ministry of love where he's loving the people of Israel when he goes and does this. So let's recap just a little bit here. So this is what's happening. So Aaron, he bears the names of the nation, goes in carrying the guilt of their sins to the throne of God, and he's the only one authorized to do it. Through the proper shedding of blood, so through the sacrifices of blood on the altar, God's wrath is appeased. It's temporary appeasement, isn't it? So it's temporarily appeased so that they can be cleansed of sin and receive the blessings God wants to give. That's how God has set all this up. Otherwise, he can't be on earth because the earth's full of dark, sinful, evil people. But that's how he's going to cleanse them. That's how he's going to redeem them. And all of this was just a shadow. This is just a shadow of what was to come. So Jesus is greater. He's so much greater. Jesus is the greater priesthood than Aaron. And why? Why? Why is he greater? Jesus bears the sins of every human who's ever lived. That's why it's greater. And Jesus bears the sins of every human that's ever lived one time as the perfect sacrifice for all of time. 1 John 2:2 says, he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. So Jesus' sacrifice on the cross when he shed his blood atones for your sin. It's covered. You can be forgiven. It transcends space and time. Jesus' blood is perfect blood because Jesus merited perfect righteousness. That means Jesus did what we could never do. He obeyed God perfectly. Have you ever had a bad thought about another person? You don't have to amen. You don't have to say anything. We've all felt those feelings. We've all been guilty. So we just don't disobey in behavior. We disobey in our attitude. Jesus obeyed with perfect attitude. Perfect thoughts. Perfect feelings. Perfect feelings. Every situation, perfect feelings. And all of that righteousness is yours. It's given to you. And then he takes all of your imperfect feelings and guilt and all of your pettiness and pride, and he'll bear the guilt of that. He'll take it, and he'll be crucified. So here's what else that makes Jesus greater. Jesus took all of God's wrath. Not just a little bit of wrath, it's all of God's wrath. If you were to go to a fire hydrant and pop that thing open with your hydraulic wrench, because that's what you'd need, you'd realize there's a lot of pressure behind that fire hydrant. And all that pressure that spills out in your face, you would deserve. Because you shouldn't have opened it up. All of us are created to honor God. But when we dishonor God, we open something that we shouldn't open. And that's the justice of God against us for dishonoring him. And we get the full force of it. Unless you have Jesus. Unless you accept Christ. Unless you believe. Because Christ took all that wrath, every last drop from that fire hydrant of justice, he took right in the face for us so we wouldn't have to. Jesus is a better priesthood. Jesus makes us into people who become priests. Isn't that amazing? So the power of Jesus' priesthood is he turns us into intercessors too. How so? We take the message of Jesus to others who need forgiveness, who need grace. We all have neighbors who don't know God. They don't know the blessings of God's love. They don't have a relationship with God. And yet, we're called a royal priesthood. In 1 Peter, we're called this kingdom of priests who are the intercessors, who go in and bring salvation to them because Jesus has done that for us. Jesus' priesthood is greater than Aaron's because Jesus' priesthood is permanent. Isn't that amazing? So if we are a kingdom of priests, Jesus says that the gates of hell can't even stand against us, that his priesthood will never fade away. Jesus' priesthood is greater. It's permanent. Are you a part of that priesthood? Are you set apart? Are you consecrated? Can you think for a moment of any greater love than what Christ has shown you with his priesthood? What greater love could we receive than the gift of forgiveness through Christ's shedding of blood? Isn't it amazing that God remembers us? God remembers you. I think there's a huge point of application here for believers. So if you're a Christian, and you're believing the gospel, you've repented of sin, and you keep repenting, and you put your faith in Christ alone for the forgiveness of sins, you are now capable of loving people like Jesus loved you. That's what's amazing and shocking. You have this ability that the rest of the world doesn't have, unless they believe, to love people like Christ has loved you. Aaron's priesthood was no easy task, was it? I mean, it was a grind, but it was loving. He had to play out the drama of judgment and forgiveness all the time. Day after day, month after month, year after year. Have you ever field-dressed a deer? It is something else. Aaron is doing this with animals all the time for the sake of the people. And yet Christ was gutted. Christ was sacrificed. Christ didn't offer the animal. He offered himself. And he was slayed. What a grind. What an act of love. So that we could be blessed. We could be healed, forgiven, redeemed. So let's show that love. So here's what I think about Christian love. Because I think the Bible talks about this a lot. Jesus certainly did. Let's be willing to endure pain and endure suffering for the sake of giving blessing. That's love. That's the love of Christ. Being willing to endure pain and suffering for the sake of giving blessing. That's the kind of kingdom we're becoming. If you're a Christian, showing love isn't always fun. Showing love isn't convenient. You might experience harm by showing love. You might experience abandonment. You might experience injustice trying to show someone love. That makes us mad, doesn't it? It aggravates us. Showing love like Christ shows love might mean doing what you don't want to do. See, a lot of times we think about love, is this something I want to do? That's not how Christ shows us love. Christ shows us love by doing what he didn't want to do. He doesn't want to die on the cross. Yet, the text says in Hebrews 4, for the joy set before him. So it was after the cross, right? There was a joy there, but it's beyond the cross. He endured the cross, scorning its shame. He scorned it. He scorned the shame of that. There's shame there. And he took that so we wouldn't have to be shamed. We can pass through too when we follow him by faith. Showing the love of Christ might be doing something you don't want to do. And you might not want to do it for a long time for the sake of blessing others and loving someone. And we need more of this in the church. I really do. I really do think this. We need more of this kind of love. We might have to do things we don't want to do. Or we might have to do things that we're not good at. Or we might have to do things that are incredibly awkward. You know, it's incredibly awkward sometimes showing love. It's certainly inconvenient sometimes. And we don't know who our neighbor might be. That's the beauty of the gospel, isn't it? Because Jesus said the whole law is summed up in these two commands. Love the Lord with all your heart. Love your neighbor as yourself. But he certainly doesn't specify who that neighbor is. Jesus doesn't get to choose. He didn't get to choose. He receives. And he received you. He received me. Wow. Who are we? What have we done? He received us with an extravagant love. Is that not what Jesus did for us on the cross when he was stripped naked? When he was stripped and accused, he was humiliated, he was abandoned, he was despised. How awkward would it have been? What a scene. And yet he did that so that we could be welcomed into the presence of God. What a wonderful presence that is. God, your Creator welcomes you into his presence through the love of Christ. One of the most mature and wise, I would say, spirit-filled believers I've ever met was a woman named Colette Harry. And she wasn't a leader of any ministry in the church. She didn't have a PhD in theology. She was a nurse by trade. And she had a lot of kids. She had a lot of grandkids. And she would work the third shift at the hospital to make money for her family. And she would work 12-hour shifts. And she would choose to work on Saturday night because, of course, no one else wants to do that. So she's going to work on Saturday night, 12-hour shift. And she would come and serve in the nursery at church. So she'd work all night, and then she'd come and serve in the nursery at church, and then she'd go home after that, and I assume went to sleep. But she did this for years and years and years without complaining. In the years that Julie and I knew her, we didn't hear her grumble about one thing. And she did so many other things to serve us. One time she was watching our kids for us so we could, like, go have a date. And Maya was a baby, and she was watching Maya, and she couldn't get Maya to go to sleep in the crib, and she didn't call us. She gave Maya a coin. She's like, hold on to this, Maya. And then when somehow it put Maya to sleep. It was like a magic coin. And she, when we got home, she said, I hope it's okay. I gave her a coin. We're like, oh, it's fine. She's like, she went to sleep with it. We're like, it'll be okay. You know, because every parent's worried about their kid, their baby, especially their first baby, you know, sleeping at night. And so anyway, we walked in there, and Maya's holding that coin like this on her back. She was diagnosed, Colette was, with a very rare kind of brain cancer. And she was given 6 to 9 months to live, which she did. And then she passed away. And we had to move. We moved her to Palmyra before she actually went to be with Jesus in heaven. But what Julie and I remember so clearly was that before we left, we were talking with her, and she had a hard time seeing. She couldn't see really well near the end because of her tumor in her brain. And we were asking her how she was, how we could pray for her, about her family. All of her family came into town, and they're there. And she didn't want to talk about her. She said, I don't want to talk about me. Let's talk about you. How can my family help you? How can we serve you? You're getting ready to make a transition. Because that's who she was. That's the kind of servant she was. And I remember sitting in my office here watching the funeral online, and as I'm sitting there weeping, and you hear all of her family. And she had all of her kids are believers. Two of them were married to two pastors. All these grandkids, a heritage of faith. The one thing they kept referring to over and over again was how great her her love was for everybody. That's the love of God. That can only be explained by really understanding Christ's love. And that's what we all need. We need it. But that's what we all give too. We all give it. We have that capability. And if we have a problem with another believer, or if we have a problem with another neighbor, I do think we have a love of God problem. You know, and there's dimensions to that. There's different ways we show that. There's nuances to it. But it's still always present because Jesus' priesthood is a priesthood of love. It's a priesthood of love. And that love never ends. So if you're having trouble loving other brothers and sisters in Christ with sacrifice, or if you're getting offended by having to do that, or if you're having trouble doing that with a neighbor, and you're, like me, quickly coming up with justifications for not doing that, then let's reprogram our love. Let's repent. Let's reprioritize what it means to love someone like Christ has loved us. And let's offer our lives as a living sacrifice. Is that not what Romans 12 says? Offer our lives, amen, as a living sacrifice. And it's so wonderful to know that we've got that kind of power within us. So in this passage, actually, there's one more aspect to thinking about the kind of motivation you need to love like that. Because it's one thing to see that in Scripture, the love of Christ and its sacrifice and how good it is. But, man, how do you apply that motivation? Well, it's in verse 29. So go back to verse 29 and look at the very end. This is what Aaron does with his priesthood. To bring them to regular remembrance before the Lord. That phrase, remembrance before the Lord, is an incredible phrase. So the God of the galaxies remembers you, always. And he remembers us through Jesus. So Jesus was raised from the dead, he's sitting at the right hand of the throne of God, and he's making intercession right now for you and I. And always and forever, no matter what, God remembers you. God remembers you. What more motivations do you need? God remembers you. Man. People tend to forget that, I think. Your name is graven onto the hands of Christ. Your name is written on his heart. You know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid you thence depart. We sing this, we love it. Don't think the next time you have an opportunity to show love, don't think the planets have to align first. You know? Everything has to be just right. It has to be the right time. It has to be the right tools you need. You got to be in the right place. It needs to be the right person. You got to have the right gifting. You have to have the right calling. We don't need to remember all of that. We don't. Why? Because we just need to remember one thing. God loves you. God loves you. How much love do you think that is? He loves you. He sent his one and only Son to embrace your sin, all of your sin. He loves you. That's so much love, you don't have to keep track of it. Imagine having so much money in your bank account. Maybe some of you can, I don't know. You don't have to keep track of it. And you can spend it as much as you want every day. Every day you could spend it. You don't have to keep a checkbook. That's how much love God has poured into our hearts, the Bible says. It's there. It's there, man. Isn't that awesome? God has done that for you and me. He's done that for us. What obstacle or challenge do we have that God's love doesn't overcome? I'm preaching to myself. I tell you what, man. I mean, I'm just telling you. I could have a therapy session with you. We all have challenges and obstacles, so many, and we need to hear the truth. God remembers you. He remembers you specifically in your pain and your heartache and your circumstances and your troubles and your timing and your life. He sees you. He knows you. He loves you no matter what. No matter what you've done, Christ died for you. You're forgiven, man. Be free. Show love. So then we spin the love, right? And we just keep spinning and spinning and spinning and spinning, and it's hard and it's grind and it's sacrifice and it's a lot of things. Our feelings may not line up with it, but we keep going. We keep going. We keep showing it. We keep giving it. And we realize then, it's then, right? It's then that we realize just how much God loves us, how much we have to give. So of all the things you could be remembered for, and of all the things we could be remembered for as a church, I was thinking about this as we thought about Bill and Carolyn and how they went to be with Jesus and about their lives and their legacy. I was thinking the same thing. Of all the things you could be remembered for, and you could be remembered as a great teacher. You can be remembered as a great parent. You can be remembered as a great friend. You can be remembered as a great musician or a public servant or whatever. Let's make it our aim to be remembered as people who loved like Christ, who loved others well, who was willing to look beyond all the issues and then redeem every single last one. Because the love of Christ taught us, showed us, and helped us. And we saw God redeem lives. We saw God do what only God can do. That's what we want, isn't it? Salvation is something only God can do. And we can be on the front row of watching God do miracles in and through us. Let's pray and ask the Lord to help us. Lord God, help us remember your love. Lord Jesus, you are our great high priest. You went before us so that we might pick up our crosses and follow you. So help us to deny ourselves, pick up our crosses, follow you, and look for opportunities. Make us mindful of those opportunities to show love. And it might mean different things. It might mean speaking truth where truth needs to be spoken. It might mean listening and receiving truth spoken to us. Make us humble so that we can be willing to show others your love. And we ask this for your name's sake, we pray. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue worshiping together and responding to God together?
How great a chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your light. has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Yours is the victory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. My living hope. God, you are my living hope.
Amen. Please be seated. Let's pray together as the ushers come forward to take the offering. Lord God, you are our living hope, a hope that's alive. Your word says in 1 Corinthians 13 that love hopes all things. We pray that you would so bless each of us individually and us as a ministry as we seek to show your love. We need your help. We need your spirit at work in us. We want your spirit to produce fruit, to create results that glorify you in how we love the community well, how we love one another well and our families well. Help us to make the most of every opportunity. We pray for our fall ministry lineup with Kingdom Kids and Moose Fest and all the ways we can serve the school system. And we pray that you would give us favor, that you would give us hope, that you would give us good news to give. We pray that you would help us build bridges with people who need a relationship with you. They need redemption. They need a change of heart, change of mind, change of perspective. Help us to show them your love and how you so love them. Lord, we pray for those in our midst, in our church, who are struggling. We think of Gary and Linda James. We think of Ethel, and there are others that are just continuing to endure. I think of Brother Jim and just others that are enduring suffering and hardship and trial physically. Please help them. Please anoint them with your love and grace and all your mercies, God. Help us relationally as a church, for the relationships that are broken, for families under stress, for not knowing how to help one another or receive help, for all the spiritual issues that are there. Would you please provide healing, help, grace, comfort from your Holy Spirit? You're the great comforter of those who need comfort. We pray that you would provide that. We think of other churches, Lord, in Palmyra and in our Bethel Association, Lord. We just pray that you would help them. We think of the Presbyterian Church, Lord, here in town, as they're still without a pastor. Please help them. Help their ministries. Help them to flourish and grow. We think of Mission Hill and just the hospitality they showed us this week with the Andreessens. Help them, Lord. Help their ministries to flourish. Help the gospel to go forth from them clearly. And Lord, for all the other things that are on our hearts and minds, all the things we pray about, all the things that burden us, would you lift burden now? Would you minister to us by your Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
can rescue me from my failure? Who else can offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. Come and worship the holy
people said. Amen. I'd encourage you this morning, if the Holy Spirit speaks to you and convicts you and is telling you of your need for salvation, I'd love to talk with you. I'd love to help you take those next steps of walking with Christ, repenting of sin, believing in Jesus and in His atoning blood. And if you do believe in Jesus and you do believe in His atoning blood, but you struggle, talk, connect, let's help one another know the power of God's redeeming love, to really know it and to let it heal. It's so healing. It's so good. As we go out to the park, truly, help yourself. I'm going to pray for us here so we all don't have to wait for me to pray out there. And so please just go and help yourself, and we'll see you out there. Let's pray together. Lord God, continue to bless our fellowship, bless our meal together, bless our new friends who are here, who may be new and who may be need a friend. We pray that you would make us as hospitable as you are, so that blessings might flow through us. We ask in your name. Amen. Go in Him.